Hey everyone, so today we are going to talk about gamma function. It's one of the example of a non-elementary function. Now one can ask, what is non-elementary function? So well, one of the categorization of a function is elementary function and a non-elementary function. So what are elementary functions? So it's a function that can be defined by taking the sum, product and composition of finitely many algebraic, rational, trigonometric, hyperbolic and exponential functions and their inverses as well, like logarithms, inverse trigonometry, inverse hyperbolic. So that finite word is important. Then such class of functions are called as elementary functions, and which cannot be expressed in those finite terms, then such functions are called as non-elementary functions. Well, there can be full dedicated lecture series on non-elementary functions. But yeah, those who are interested, they can Google the phrase non-elementary function. And if an integral involves this non-elementary functions, then such integrals are called as non-elementary integrals. Okay, so not all integrals can be expressed in terms of elementary functions. Like you can do for integration of sine, cos, basic hyperbolic, basic trigonometry, basic exponential. Those can be expressed in terms of elementary function, but not all functions. Okay, so like for example, we know that sine square x, you can integrate this, you get answer in terms of elementary functions. But if you try to integrate sine of x square, then you won't get answer in terms of elementary function. Non-elementary functions do come into picture. Okay, or so if I ask you what is e raised to x upon x or e raised to minus x upon x. So all this, when you try to integrate, there are plenty more. Then the answer will come in terms of non-elementary functions, and that's why they are very important to study, and you'll be coming across such integrals a lot once you go to your fourth, third year or final year of engineering. Okay, so now why I'm introducing here in the calculus course, because in earlier lecture we talked about improper integrals of type 1 and 2, and this gamma function falls into the category of improper integrals of type 1. So this is a good point, or this is a good time to talk about gamma functions. So now we will first see the definition of gamma function, then we will see some nice properties that gamma function follows, and then some examples involving some tricks which will help you to solve problems on gamma functions. So gamma function is denoted by this function gamma, capital gamma. Well, you must have seen this in your high school or something. This is a small gamma and this is called as a capital gamma. Okay, so gamma function is a function from a domain D to real numbers. What is my domain D? It is all real numbers except 0 and negative integers. Okay, so if you have a real number system, domain includes all the points except 0, minus 1, minus 2, minus 3 and so on. Okay, so this whole thing is in the domain except this in negative integers and the 0. So this is the domain for gamma function. And how do you define it? So gamma, you take any alpha from the domain D, it is defined as integral 0 to infinity. As you can see, the domain is unbounded, so it falls under improper integral. It is nothing but t raised to this input minus 1 into e raised to minus t dt. Okay, well, when alpha is supposed minus half, then this what this will be t raised to minus 3 by 2 and it will come down. So you can see it also falls under the category of improper integral of type 2, because at 0 it is not defined, right? And but when it is greater than 1, then it is only improper integral of type 1. So yeah, it falls under both the types depending upon different values of alpha. Okay, so this is how you define the gamma function. Okay, so just keep this in mind, this input goes to here and you're integrating with respect to t. Okay, so if I want to just make you feel better, let us try to see what is gamma of 1. Where does 1 goes to? It is 0 to infinity t raised to 1 minus 1, which is t raised to 0, which is 1, e raised to minus t dt. And this we have solved in our lecture on improper integral of type 1. Let me solve for you if you have not seen that lecture, but my suggestion is please go through it. So this is a definition of improper integral, and then when you do the integration, what you have, minus e raised to minus c plus e raised to minus 1, sorry, e raised to 0. And when you apply limit c going to infinity, this goes to 0 and here this is 1 only. So the answer is 1. So gamma of 1 is 1. So answer is gamma 1 goes to 1 under this function. What will be gamma of 0, minus 1, minus 2? It does not exist. That's why they are not in the domain. Okay. So yeah. So that's one thing. Now let's try to see some nice properties of gamma functions. See, like this was a small number 1. If I ask you what is gamma of say 1000, then what you will have? Gamma of 1000 will be t raised to 1000 minus 1, which is nothing but t raised to 999. And then you need to apply integration by parts 999 times, which is not possible, right? I mean, it's impossible to solve such a big problem. So do we have some nice relation involving these gamma functions so that such calculation becomes easier? Answer is yes. So let's try to see those properties first. So here is the first property. So this is a definition I have written because we need to use this. So gamma of alpha plus 1 is nothing but you remove 1, so alpha into gamma alpha. So that's how one can keep in mind. So we start with the left hand side. So by definition, what is this? What is gamma of alpha plus 1? It is t raised to input minus 1. Input is what? Alpha plus 1. So input minus 1 means input minus 1 e raised to minus t dt. Okay, and what is this? This is integral 0 to infinity t raised to alpha e raised to minus t dt. Now you can solve. So by definition of improper integral, this is limit c going to infinity integral 0 to c t raised to alpha e raised to minus t dt. Now what you do is you apply integration by parts. So what do you do? What do you have? When you try to do that, this is t raised to alpha minus e raised to minus t 0 to c minus integration 0 to c. You will have this is alpha t raised to alpha minus 1 and integration of this is minus e raised to minus t dt. Now you apply the upper and the lower limit. So when c goes to infinity, this goes to 0 e raised to minus c. So you have 1 upon infinity which goes to 0. And when you apply lower limit, because of this t raised to alpha, this becomes 0. So ultimately this term is 0. Here you can take out alpha outside. So when I take out alpha outside, what is left? You apply the limit. So it is integral 0 to infinity t raised to alpha minus 1 e raised to minus t dt. But what is this? This is nothing but gamma of alpha. So alpha into gamma alpha. So this is one of the very nice recurring property of gamma function that we are going to use a lot while solving the problems involving gamma functions. Okay, and this is true for all alpha in my domain. Okay, good. Now what about if I replace my this alpha by a natural number n plus 1, where what is my n? N is my natural number. Then what is by this property? I have n into gamma of n. So you reduce 1. So if I reduce 1 from n plus 1, what is left? N. So n into gamma n. Now what is this gamma n by this property? So I can rewrite this as n minus 1 plus 1. So what is this? Alpha plus 1. Alpha is n minus 1. So n minus 1 into gamma of n minus 1. Right? What is this? N into n minus 1. What is this? You reduce 1 and gamma of n minus 2. So what is this? N, n minus 1, n minus 2. You again reduce 1. N minus 3 up to 3 into 2 into at the end. You will have 1. N is natural number, it will stop at 1. And what is gamma of 1? We just now saw that is nothing but 1 only. So this is nothing but n factorial. So see, you can see that gamma function is a generalization of a factorial function, because when I restrict it to natural number, it is nothing but n factorial. Okay, so yeah, so gamma of n plus 1 is n factorial. And now you can easily tell me the answer. If I ask you, what is gamma of 1000? It's a natural number. So you just reduce 1 and give a factorial sign. So you reduce 1, 999, and give a factorial sign. So this becomes a very easy problem, right? Otherwise, you need to go by the definition, which is a very tricky job. Okay? And if someone asks you, what is gamma of 1000 upon what is gamma of 999. What is this? This is 999 factorial upon 998 factorial. So the answer is 999. Otherwise, if you don't know the relation, if you try to do this by definition, integral upon integral, you can't even think of solving. So yeah, that's how this property makes your life very easy. Okay, but one more thing, this is only true for natural number. Okay, many times when I ask what is gamma of 3/2, what they say, they just reduce 1 from here. So 3/2 - 1 is 1/2, and they say 1/2 factorial. No, this is not true for rational numbers or the negative real numbers. It's only true for the natural numbers. Okay, so yeah, so this is the one property which is true for every alpha in the domain, and this is for the natural numbers. The third property that we are going to use is gamma of half. The answer is root pi. Okay, well, to prove this I will need double integration, but since we are in the single variable playlist, so I'm assuming that you are not knowing double integration. But if you know double integration, then do give a shot to try to prove this. Well, this can also be proved using beta function that I'm going to talk in my next lecture. So once we see beta function and the relation between beta and gamma function, we can try to prove this. Okay, and the second thing I'm going to use is gamma of alpha into gamma of 1 - alpha. When I'm taking the product of gamma functions, where these two input add up to 1. If you see the addition, alpha plus 1 - alpha is 1. Then this is nothing but pi upon sine of alpha pi, where my alpha is 0 to 1. 0 less than alpha less than 1. Again, this is an integral, this is an integral. You're taking a product, so it involves double integration. So that's why I'm going to skip this proof as well. Okay, so these are the four properties, and now let's try to solve some problems. So for natural number, you know, it is nothing but you reduce 1 and give a factorial sign. But if I ask you what is gamma of 3/2, then what you will do, we try to use that recurring property. So you try to write 3/2 as something plus 1. So this is nothing but 1/2 + 1. So what is gamma of alpha plus 1? It is alpha into gamma of alpha. But what is gamma of half? It is root pi. So gamma of 3/2 is root pi/2. So it becomes hardly two line answer. If you go by definition, it may take lot of time. What is gamma of pi/2? This is nothing but gamma of something plus 1. What will be this something? 3/2. So what is this? This is alpha into gamma of alpha. Now what is gamma of 3/2? Again do the same thing, gamma of 1/2 + 1, but that we did over here, so I'm not repeating the same procedure here. So this is root pi/2, so answer is 3√π/4. So that's how you can solve this kind of problems. Okay, so simply write it as something plus 1 and use the recurring property, and you can go till the like 1/2 or 1/3, wherever you can go till. Okay, that's one thing. Suppose if you have negative, what is gamma of -5/2? If someone asks you this, then you can't apply the same technique which we did just now. If you try to write this as something plus 1, then this has to be -7/2, because -7/2 + 1 is -5/2. And what is this? This is -7/2 into gamma of -7/2. Now what is this? -7/2 into gamma of, if I want to write it as something plus 1, this will be what? -9/2. And again by the recurring property, -7/2 - 9/2 into gamma of -9/2. Then again that you can write it as -11/2 - 13/2, and the process will go on, it will never stop. So the technique which we applied for positive fraction will not exactly happen for the negative fraction. So question is how to solve that problem if you have a negative fraction by 2. Then well, in such scenario, you go the reverse way. Like I know that gamma of half is what? Root pi. How can I write half as something plus 1? So this is nothing but -2, right? If -2 + 1 is +2. So I'm rewriting half as -2 + 1. Now what is gamma of alpha plus 1? It is alpha into gamma alpha. This is root pi. Again do the same thing. This is -2. How will you write -2 as something plus 1? You write it as -3/2 + 1. Okay, this is equal to root pi. Now again the same thing. What is gamma of alpha plus 1? Alpha into gamma alpha. So minus half into minus 3 by 2 is 3 by 4 into gamma of minus 3 by 2. Now I want minus 5 by 2, right? So what is again minus 3 by 2 can be written as, so this nothing but, so what I have, gamma of minus 3 by 2 is, you take 4 over there, so I have 4 root pi by 3. Now again the same thing, this is minus 5 by 2 plus 1, and again minus 5 by 2 will come outside, so gamma of minus 5 by 2 is minus 8 upon 15 root pi. So minus 5 by 2 will come outside, then 4 2 is 8, 5 3 is 15. So that's how one can solve for negative fractions. Now suppose the question is on product of gamma function. So you can recall the fourth property which we proved. So try to see whether the addition of the input is 1. So 1 by 4 plus 3 by 4 is, yes, it is 1. So this is nothing but gamma of 1 by 4 into gamma of 1 minus 1 by 4. So gamma of alpha into gamma of 1 minus alpha. And by that fourth property, it is pi upon sine of alpha pi. So alpha is 1 by 4, so pi by 4. And your alpha is less than 1 also. So you can use this property, but this is 1 by root 2. So answer is root 2 pi. So see, I mean, if you know these good properties, you get answers in 2 lines. So that's why these properties are very much important. And that's why gamma function used a lot. Okay, now let us go for another example. Suppose I want to integrate e raised to minus x squared dx. When I asked you in my earlier lecture, if you recall, on improper test for convergence on improper integrals, there we saw that it was difficult to integrate. So then we see that can we at least tell whether this converges or diverges, and then we used direct comparison test and we proved that this is convergent. But now we are actually going to find the value of this. Okay, so now you see 0 to infinity and exponential. Whenever you see these two things, exponential and 0 to infinity, always think of gamma function. So okay, now by looking at this, okay, I'm thinking of gamma function, good. But in the definition of gamma function, what do I have? It is integral 0 to infinity t raised to alpha minus 1 e raised to minus t dt, e raised to minus t. Here I'm having e raised to minus x square. So what substitution I will do to solve this, I will substitute x square equal to t. So when I do this substitution, my limits will remain the same, 0 to infinity e raised to minus t into what is dx, it is dt upon 2x, because 2x dx is dt. So what is this? This is nothing but integral 0 to infinity 1 by 2, and the x is nothing but root t. So this root t will come at the top, so t raised to minus half e raised to minus t dt. Now what alpha will I put here so that this will be equal to this, because e raised to minus t is there, I have t raised to minus half. So if I take gamma of half, when I put alpha equal to 1 by 2, I get 0 to infinity t raised to 1 by 2 minus 1, which is minus half. Good. So this is nothing but, this integral is nothing but gamma half. If you don't know, then you can stop here. But you know gamma half is root pi, so the answer is root pi by 2. So integral 0 to infinity e raised to minus x square dx is root pi by 2. What will be integral minus infinity to infinity e raised to minus x square? Now since it's an even function, you can write this as 2 times 0 to infinity. In that scenario, your answer will be root pi. Okay, so that's the hint, I would say, that whenever you have integral 0 to infinity and exponential, think of gamma function. So here is another trickier problem. So here you have integral 0 to infinity and you have an exponential function. Okay, right? So number raised to variable means exponential function. So if you recall, you can always see what is e raised to ln x. It is nothing but x, right? Because e and ln are inverses of each other. So I can write 3 raised to x as e raised to ln of 3 raised to x, because e ln goes away, you have 3 raised to x. Now by property of ln, you can take this x at the front. So if I do this smart adjustment over here, I have x cube divided by e raised to x ln 3. So e raised to minus x ln 3 dx. So I got e into the picture. okay, because of this smart adjustment. Okay, now again by gamma function we know that we want e raised to minus t. So what substitution you will do over here is you put t equal to x ln of 3. So what will be my dt? It is ln 3 is a constant dx. Good. Now if I do the substitution, so when x is 0, t is 0. When x is infinite, t is infinite. So my limits remains the same. X cube, what is x cube? It is t upon ln 3, because my x is t upon ln 3 cube e raised to minus t. And what is my dx? Dt upon ln 3. So my 1 upon ln 3 raised to 4 will come outside integral 0 to infinity t cube e raised to minus t dt. What is the definition of gamma function? T raised to alpha minus 1. So my alpha has to be 4, because 4 minus 1 is 3. So this is 1 upon ln 3 raised to 4. This is gamma of 4. What is gamma of 4? It's 3 factorial. So this is nothing but 6 upon ln 3 raised to 4. So here are some homework problems. So again, the first one, you can see 0 to infinity and exponential in the picture. Good. You should think of gamma function e raised to minus x cube. So you will put x cube equal to t, so that you get e raised to minus t, and you can think of applying the definition of gamma function. So the hint is put x cube equal to t. This one we just now saw, there I took c equal to 3. Now I just give it a general question to solve. Again the same thing, right? C raised to x is e raised to x ln of c. The same way, try to solve this. And here again you can see e raised to minus x raised to 4. So again the obvious choice is you put x raised to 4 equal to t. So that's the trick. Whenever you see this 0 to infinity and e raised to something, think of gamma function. So your job is to comment the answer for these three questions. And if you get stuck, that also you can ask me. If you have some other problems in gamma function, that also you can ask me. And if everything is clear, then yes, do not forget to like, share and subscribe. Thank you.